Welcome, and thank you for coming out on this cold evening to this wonderful place. I start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land, acknowledging the Bedjigal people, who are the traditional custodians of this land. And I'd also like to pay my respects to the elders, both past and present, and extend that respect to other Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders who may be here present today. This is the inaugural Roger Covell lecturer by the inaugural Roger Covell Fellow, Professor Stephen Feld, entitled The Ethics and Aesthetics of Cosmopolitan Listening. It's not my job to introduce Stephen or to introduce the lecture, but I do want to say something about the fellowship, which represents this faculty and this university's way of acknowledging and celebrating Roger Covell's extraordinary contribution both to this university and to classical music culture more broadly in Australia. Roger, as I'm sure many of you know, is Professor Emeritus in the School of the Arts and Media, and he was the founding head of our School of Music and Music Education. He is, of course, also an eminent musicologist, critic, and author. Roger continues to be engaged with UNSW through the activities of the Australia Ensemble, of which he was the co-founder. And it's absolutely appropriate to honour Roger Covell through the establishment of this fellowship. Roger is overseas at present, but I've been asked to read this message from him. Roger says, "I am greatly honoured by the action of my colleagues in instituting the Roger Covell Fellowship. That honour is compounded by the visit of the much admired American scholar Stephen Feld as first holder of the fellowship. Professor Feld's work in what he calls acoustomology first came to international attention as a result of his researches in the music and other sounds of Papua New Guinea. His revelations from that region have been followed by parallel or at least kindred discoveries of the interaction of musical impulses between species in Europe, Africa, and elsewhere. I envy anyone who has the privilege of hearing at first hand what Stephen Feld has to say, and regret that arrangements involving long-term studies of my own in other countries had to be made before it was possible to know the date of his visit here." As I say, I'm not introducing the lecture, but I'm going to introduce the introducer. Manolete Mora is Associate Professor of Music and Convener of the Music Program in the School of the Arts and Media. His research includes the music of Southeast Asia, in particular the Philippines and Indonesia, Dagaba ritual music in Ghana, and the African diaspora in southern China. He established UNSW's Balinese gamelan, Suitra Jaya, which gave its inaugural recital last week to a packed house in this place. And he is currently working on an ARC-funded project in the Riau Islands of Indonesia. Mano, I would like to say, was also the inspiration behind setting up this fellowship. So I'd like to thank him for that and also say that how appropriate it is for him to introduce its first recipient. Mano.
Stephen Feld's research centres on the anthropology of senses, sound and voice, and integrates linguistics and poetics, music and aesthetics, acoustics and ecology, and the politics of world music into that research. This evening, Stephen Feld will be talking about the ethics and aesthetics of cosmopolitan listening, a topic that emanates from diverse listening experiences in Ghana, and which shows us, in the words of musicologist Tony Mitchell, I quote, that a better world is possible, and that the cosmopolitanism that matters always comes from below, end of quote. Thank you, and let's warmly welcome, please, Stephen Feld.
Thank you very much. I'm excited and honored to be here as the inaugural Roger Covell Fellow, and I want to extend my thanks to the School of Arts and Media for this invitation, and especially to Manolete Mora for so generously proposing and organizing my visit, and for his overly generous introduction. These days of conversations with students, as well as with research and art acquaintances, both old and new, have really been a great pleasure, and I want to thank you all for coming. I want to thank the Creative Practice Lab for such a hospitable venue, and I want to extend a very special thanks to those in the audience with whom I've had the pleasure of many years, in some cases 25, 30 and more years of visits and conversations, and your presence here tonight and long friendship really mean a great deal to me. I came to know Roger Covell's music writing as a reader of the Sydney Morning Herald during a 1993 teaching exchange semester at the University of Sydney. That led me to his book on Australia's classical music history, as well as to his choral collaborations with Peter Sculthorpe. Professor Covell's public intellectual voice as critic, scholar, and creative practitioner is precisely the mix I'll try to weave together in tonight's talk. To do so is also to strongly endorse a core aim of this fellowship, as posted at his website, and I quote that, to encourage the public to investigate music's power to critique and to express contemporary social experience. So, cosmopolitan listening. What I'll be taking up is the ethical and aesthetic value or sensibility of listening beyond horizons, beyond boundaries, beyond borders, listening across expanses of location, listening beyond what is presumed incommensurable, listening across the divides, gulfs, and hurts of history, culture, art, listening across species and technologies, in all, listening that performs cosmopolitan ethics and aesthetics by the ways it might acknowledge, engage, promote, and perform both expansive imagination and a solidarity indifference. I want to take you into these issues through acoustomology, through sound as a way of knowing, which I take to be a study of listening as a knowing in action, a knowing with and knowing through the audible. And the key question I'll ask you to consider is how sonic knowing can create emancipatory projects, projects that both acknowledge difference and produce new translations and new possibilities for expansive listening. I traveled to Accra, Ghana in 2004 after 4 years of research on bells in 6 European countries. I decided to pause from the campanological curiosities of the old world to explore how West African musicians and blacksmiths might present a contemporary perspective on bells, like the gankoki instrument you see here, well known to play a critical timekeeping or metronomic role in West African ensemble musics. But before I heard a single bell or met a single musician or blacksmith in Accra, I encountered a different chronotopic index of terrific acoustic presence. The very late night croaking by this common toad, the one Western science calls Bufo regularis. Don't let the Latin name equivalent of the ordinary clown fool you. These toads have done something very serious. They've colonized Accra's sewers, living 2 feet deep in concrete gutters flanking most of the city's roads. Intrigued by how the sounds of the toads were intensely amplified by the cement walls of these fetid amphitheaters, I began recording them, my mind racing ahead to the possibility that someday, somehow, I might be able to play them back and open a conversation about the people in Accra's ability to hear this differently to how I was hearing it. Also in my first week in Accra, I met the mighty percussionist Niotu Anan, and I heard him play Afro jazz with multi-instrumentalist Ninoy Norty. In 2005, I excitedly returned to Accra at their invitation for an intense month of bell study with Niotu and to record his and Ninoy's tribute to John Coltrane's Love Supreme. I returned again for 6 months the next year to join their band and to resume my lessons with Niotu. During these years, I came to know about Niotu's perpetual struggle in the class ranks of the working poor as a non-literate musical laborer. But I also learned how he's locally renowned for his uncommon mastery of multiple musical idioms. Fiercely committed to living musically in the plural, he participates in Ga ritual activities as a first call traditional drum master. He participates equally as either percussionist, guitarist, or electric bassist in popular ensembles performing high life, as well as in churches performing gospel. He also plays African jazz, American style jazz, and has now become Ghana's premier experimental avant-garde free jazz percussionist. In 2007, I again returned to Accra for 6 months, and by then I knew Niyotu very well, and while continuing as his student, was also performing, touring, and recording with him in Ghana, Europe, and the United States. Toward the end of my stay that year, I finally played for him a 6-minute toadscape that I made as a sound art commission for the 2006 Ear to the Earth Festival in New York. Starts with me walking down the street at midnight, creating a metronome. Niyotu listened to this, and when he took off his headphones, he spoke a short but revelatory statement. "You hear, Prof? It's like what I'm explaining you. The crickets are sounding everywhere, like the bell, with very strict time. And the kokodene, the name of the toad in Ga, his first language, are master drummers, making many rhythms that cross on top and sit down below." Sounding everywhere, crossing on top, sitting below, how might the metaphoric space-time concepts that Niyotu used be the shaping forces of a musical imagination? This question led us to collaborate on a recording experiment where Niyotu improvised sequentially on percussion instruments or instrument sets while listening in headphones to playback of the 6-minute toad and cricket soundscape recording. These experimental recordings open up new lines of inquiry into how routine listening to the environment forms a creative backdrop for knowledge of sonic space and time. What's revealed by this acoustomology is how Niyotu listens to the toad simultaneously as a metronomic click track, as a creative stimulus, as a calculator, and as a musical interlocutor. Indeed, his overdubs feed back the polyrhythmic math that reveal how West African master drummers simultaneously hear in patterns of 3 against 2, 4 against 3, and 6 against 4. They feed back the articulateness of hearing space-time interplays as crossing on top, sitting below, and sounding everywhere. For the Buffo Variations presentation CD recording, we begin with the original listening to Accra's gutter toads at midnight. We then proceed with Niyotu's listening in variations and end with the toads again. On 9 of the 10 overdubs, the toad tracks are taken away completely for the presentation, so that Niyotu's musical response is what is fully exposed. This encourages listening to the improvisations, but also leaves open the option to use the computer to listen simultaneously, as he did, to the Toads as they would synchronize with any of his playing along variations. To clarify the process, midway, we retain the ambient Toad track together with variation 6 for electric guitar, making it possible for the listener to hear Neo 2 playing along with what he was listening to in the moment in his headphones. And for variation 10, we hear Neo 2 overdubbed to a prior free jazz sax voice bass Toad overdubbing. These overdubbings and our understanding of them teach about the generative mathematics of many local rhythm families. They also map out Neo 2's histories of listening and musical absorption, linking species beyond the human to Ghanaian national, ethnic, and regional idioms, and over-the-border patterns that reach into Nigeria, Togo, and Burkina Faso. They also head in the direction of pop and jazz. In this way, Neo 2's cosmopolitan listening feedback speaks to how numerous Ghanaian rhythm families sound the historical and musical space and time of a city, a nation, and the interpenetration of international musics. In variation 1, for two Jill xylophones, Neo 2 says the introduction has the left hand walking to my footsteps and the right coming in to trill like the crickets. After this introduction, the left hand states patterns and the right embellishes, playing the left with two mallets and the right with one or two, as you see here. Neo 2 uses echoing and mirroring in a musical mimesis of the left-right, forward-backward sounding space of the Toads, as well as the up-and-down sounding space of the crickets. You'll also hear how the independence of the hands can be spread across the two instruments, which share a common octave, setting improvisations against ostinatos played with a jazz keyboard touch. So let's listen to part of this. This is recorded, this is Neo 2 playing as he's listening to the Toads, but the Toads have been removed. Thank you. While a respected master of both traditional Ghanaian percussion and popular and jazz musics, Neotu has had little exposure to concepts of variation in Western European art music. As he had never heard the name Johann Sebastian Bach, I decided to make the introduction by way of Goldberg Variations. Even though self-taught, Neotu has considerable knowledge of Western harmony and melodic motion from playing guitar and bass. Not surprisingly, he noticed the repeating patterns of Bach's bass line motion from one variation to the next in the Goldberg Variations. You probably all know that. Do, ti, la, so, mi, fa, so, do. The riff in that kind of is so generative in the Goldberg. But listening into the density of Bach's keyboard music, Neotu's main auditory focus was on something much more familiar in West Africa, which was the interdependence created by the independent and interlocking left and right hands. He asked me to pause the recorder numerous times to listen again to the left-right and front-back play on the double manual keyboard, an instrument he was seeing and hearing for the very first time. But it was the harpsichord's shimmering timbres that he responded to most immediately, qualities that he likened to his xylophone's spider-webbed gourd resonators. Take a moment to fantasize how Goldberg Variations might sound differently had Bach been born in Ghana, gone to sleep each night listening to toads, and devoted himself to the mastery of polyrhythm with the same ferocious passion he devoted to harmony. The variation you heard begins to address this fantasy in a rather good-humored way, with the Jill xylophones in a G major pentatonic, Neotu realizing quite instantly G major as Goldberg's home key. And in just the short segment I played for you, you heard a great deal of play between 3 and 2 in his rhythmic parsings, and as is well known, the Goldberg's grand ternary form with canon in ascent every third variation from numbers 3 to 27 is matched by contrast of binary symmetries on 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. In his book, Bach, the Goldberg Variations, the musicologist Peter Williams catalogs many of the work's recurring patterns, and some of his phraseology stands in a rather uncanny way as a descriptive lexicon for Neotu's improvisational playfulness. Some of the phrases that Williams use are angular lines and inversion, anticipation in the bass, cascading and disappearance becoming reappearance, patterns crossing, chasing, and coming together, lines appearing to go their own way, bubbling lines testing the player's hand positioning, and lines tumbling over each other, answering or running against each other, both up and down. Among Bach's variations that most intrigued Neotu, number 5 stood out. You can see from the first half of the score here the number of hand-crossing passages that are necessary to articulate this variation. And I'll show you just a little YouTube video where they're executed at rather daring speed by Glenn Gould. This is from the 1981 sessions that produced his second recording of the work, updating his well-known, audacious 1955 debut version. Let me just juxtapose that with a little video moment of Neotu experimenting with hand positioning with an instrument of his own invention, which is a series of the gankoki bells played with percussion mallets. And here you see the way he alternates close, crossed, and far hand positioning, playing percussion mallets, And I'll leave the toads in on this one, so as he was hearing them, so that you can get a better sense of the multiple metronomes that he's responding to. The Buffo Variations project, both the CD and the performances and videos that we've done in many festivals and different events in recent years, open a number of listening possibilities and ones that crisscross back and forth between African traditional and popular dance forms, improvisation, jazz, and European art music. This is a way to emphasize in equal measure collaborative, scholarly, creative, and critical ways to reveal the musical intelligence of an African musician and to facilitate possibilities for an expansive musical dialogue. The recording deliberately violates what outsiders most typically expect to hear, the virtuosity of tradition, and instead provides access to something far less experienced or imagined, African experimentalism. After the Buffo Variations recording and a US and European performance tour, Neotu and I continued our experiments to imagine and curate an acoustomological version of what the anthropologist George Marcus calls epistemic partnership, alternate models for dialogue and cultural translation. In January 2010, Neotu asked me if I would record 13 of his compositions for solo electric guitar in a jazz and pop-inflected Ghanaian highlife style. One of the pieces had a curious title that instantly stood out to me, Africa Take Five. When I asked Neotu what he meant by this, he tersely replied, Africa Take Five, mba, 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 you know it, Prof. You know the name, Dave Brubeck, but Africa way. Here's what he played. The underlying title quoted Take Five is a composition by saxophonist Paul Desmond, and it was made famous in 1959 on the Dave Brubeck Quartet Columbia LP, Time Out. Take Five became the Brubeck Group's theme song, and Time Out became the first jazz LP to achieve platinum sales in the U.S. Today, it remains among the most widely circulated, broadcast, known, and cited recordings in jazz history worldwide. An experimental exemplar of the 1950s U.S. West Coast style, cool style, Time Out opened the possibility that jazz could be improvised, indeed could swing, in time signatures beyond those conventionally based on 3 and 4 pulse cycles. The song Take Five was notably the first song to demonstrate this in the time signature of 5/4. While never acknowledged in the public, Desmond and Brubeck most likely heard musical invention in groupings of five during the group's 1958 trip, sponsored by the U.S. State Department, to India as jazz ambassadors, a sort of soft diplomacy event which has more recently been revealed by historians to have been part of a U.S. Cold War cultivation agenda, much more complicated than just jazz ambassadorship. What Neo 2 sang to me as mbop, 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 mbop is the sounding out of the count of the song's 5-pulse cycle. 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5. And that cycle and accent structure is what is announced and repeated throughout Dave Brubeck's piano part on Take Five, a left-right, left-right, left-right hand alternation of the repeated chordal vamp from E-flat minor to B-flat minor 7 over the introduction and entire A phrase of the song. Here's a little bit of that. Okay. 10 months after we recorded his 13 guitar solos, Neo 2 came to New Mexico for a teaching and performance residency with me at my university. And during his stay, he requested that we spend several nights in a recording studio. There, listening over headphones to his solo guitar recordings, he sequentially overdubbed each of the 13 pieces with 5 to 10 additional instrumental and vocal tracks. Departing for Accra a few weeks later, he slapped my hand vigorously and with his infectious grin said, "Okay, Prof, you hear the music, make the arrangements." Studying those 13 pieces occupied me for the next year. Analyzing and playing with the songs, I constructed musical arrangements to bring the overdubbed layering of instruments in and out and to expose Neo 2's engagements with many Ghanaian and international pop and jazz idioms. In 2011, I twice took back rough mixes to Accra to review for him, and in January 2012, when the work was finished, we released the CD called Ghana Sea Blues. So for Africa Take Five, Neo 2 first overdubbed his guitar with a start-to-finish track on Gankoki, a double bell. Then listening to that composite, he laid down a start-to-finish track on Dawuro, a banana leaf bell. And listening to the three together, he then put down a track playing the Shekere, a beaded gourd rattle. And then to fill out the bottom, he overdubbed a track on electric bass. And then a track with a pair of conga-type hand drums called a pentema, and another with gome, a seated bass drum played with palms and heels. So I'm going to just take you through how the initial rhythm-defining layers add up, and we'll hear how Africa Take Five creates a different way to listen to Dave Brubeck's Take Five. That's the first bell part that he laid down. Okay. Second bell part. Here's what they sound like together. Rattle. Okay, so without taking this too far into musical analysis, in the top rhythm layers, we're going to hear how Neotu's Africa Take 5 creates conditions for an Afro-Escher sketch. Listening to the composite and the breakdown, we hear how he plays an underlying pulse cycle of 6 while maintaining the feel and implication of an accent cycle in 5. What he does is take Brubeck's piano vamp, 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5, and he stretches the gestalt, so it becomes 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5, which fits perfectly in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, in other words, he references and evokes the 5-4 groove of the Brubeck Quartet's Take 5, but in the push and pull of a more symmetric, danceable, and Afrocentric 6-pulse groove. And so what we hear when they're put together is both an African listening history and a very fresh way of hearing the Brubeck Group's time experiment. So the mix just starts with the guitar and the bells and then introduces other layers. Grew up in Ghana in the 1960s, and his constant companion was the Voice of America. But he lived in a working poor world, and he had no access to magazines, LPs, or TV. Like many non-literate but radio-loving Accra listeners, Neotu heard the Voice of America jazz broadcast as a sounding site of racial pride, the sounding site of overseas blackness. He assumed proudly that African Americans were performing the entire content of the Voice of America broadcasts he so loved. He had no idea that Dave Brubeck and Paul Desmond were white, or that Voice of America was both ideologically reactionary and promoting a particular version of jazz history and pluralism. Indeed, Neotu was almost completely clueless about jazz's tensely racialized past in the 1950s and 60s. He recalled that wall paintings like these from a now defunct hotel a few blocks from his home taught him that Louis Armstrong and Gene Krupa were overseas equivalents of E.T. Mensah and Guy Warren. But as you can see here, Jean Krupa's whiteness is unmarked. Signs like that put Neotu's understanding of race and jazz at a deep distance from the USA of the late 50s and early 60s. Back then, Take Five was often taken to signify a cool jazz whose audience was imagined to consist of whites of a musically educated jazz goes to college middle class. And that discursive position was outside of what jazz's then populist black and sidekick aficionado white listenership deemed to be authentically hip, East Coast soul or groove or bebop. Many of jazz's core listeners felt strongly that the Time Out LP got disproportionate attention at a moment when jazz was becoming more politically black and more distinctly related to the civil rights struggle. Ironically, nobody agreed more than Dave Brubeck, well known for chiding the press that Duke Ellington's face should have been on the cover of Time magazine long before his own. So we end up with a sense that Neotu's creative Africanization of Take Five is multiply ironic. First, because the nationalist US jazz narrative, the narrative that racially essentialized cool white versus hot black stylistics, was completely unknown to him. And second, because the same nationalist US narrative relegated Africans to the position of jazz ancestors, actors only present in the deep past, bordered long and far outside jazz music's mid-20th century life. Nationalist jazz ethics and aesthetics denied Africans the possibility to be jazz contemporaries as early as the 1950s and 60s. That's when Guy Warren, Ghana's very gifted jazz drummer, lived and recorded these radical and popular LPs in Chicago and London, deeply influencing distinguished American jazz musicians like Max Roach and Randy Weston, and equally important pop stars, including Nigeria's Fela Kuti and the UK's Ginger Baker. But by the end of the 1960s, Warren was back in Ghana for good, claiming angrily that the American idea of jazz was a racist term that kept Africans in the past by insisting that they remain purveyors of tradition and not contemporary agents. He changed his name from Guy Warren to Ghanaba, meaning born of Ghana. He became a Buddhist, and he devoted the rest of his life to an African talking drums plus choral interpretation of Handel's Messiah. These old and new African takes on the ethics and aesthetics of border crossing combine histories of disappointment and denial with others of artistic openness, hope, and care for connection. And they can be further scrutinized by a look at the ongoing drama of the American national jazz narrative. Like this, the New York Times in November 2011 reported that the St. Regis luxury hotel chain, building a $1 billion resort in Doha, Qatar, was partnering with New York's Jazz at Lincoln Center to operate a local nightclub modeled on their Midtown venue, Dizzy's Club Coca-Cola. The project curator is the distinguished jazz artist and Jazz at Lincoln Center artistic director, Wynton Marsalis. He told the reporter that, quote, "The financial windfall matters less than the opportunity to spread American culture," unquote, and that the Doha Club's performance roster would focus on, quote, "important players from New Orleans or different periods of jazz history," unquote. Such an outlook doesn't wear its cultural imperialism with much subtlety. Doha, Qatar was, of course, the US staging site for the Iraq invasion. And on that basis alone, you'd have a difficult time convincing any African musician that jazz cosmopolitanism is about listening to the New Orleans masters in a luxury hotel bar on a military base at a venue bankrolled by Coca-Cola and controlled from Lincoln Center, New York. Contrast that with a different story about cosmopolitan listening aesthetics and ethics. In 2006, I sat with Neotu to listen carefully to a CD of the John Coltrane Quintet recorded 40 years earlier at New York's famed Village Vanguard Club. The group's drummer, Rashid Ali, was a deep inspiration to Neotu. And the next year, 2007, I helped Neotu realize a dream when the Accra train station band came to the US and played together with Rashid Ali at a festival honoring the global Coltrane legacy. Here he is with his hero. When in 2009 I called Neo to inform him of Rashid Ali's passing, he immediately replied, "Prof, I want to go to the place and pour." A little more than a year later, when he came to perform in New York City, Neo managed to sneak a small Evian bottle of homemade gin positioned in his xylophone case past U.S. Homeland Security. His first request was a trip to the Village Vanguard, where he stood under the awning and in front of the doors where Rashid Ali stood in that 1966 LP cover photo. As I filmed, Neo poured libation to honor, safeguard, and expedite Rashid Ali's forward spiritual journey. With all of that, I ask you now, can you hear Neo pumping bass to the frontliners of diasporic thinking? Isn't Africa Take Five no less Buffo variations what literary theorist Tsitsi Elajaji has been exploring about African modernities as a listening in stereo? Aren't these sorts of musical ethics and aesthetics very much what philosopher Kwame Anthony Appiah insists define the stakes in being simultaneously rooted, patriotic, and cosmopolitan? Isn't this how roots become routes in the Black Atlantic sound of sociologist Paul Gilroy? Neo2's projects epitomize what cultural historian James Clifford calls discrepant cosmopolitanism, and what anthropologist Penina Werbner, following cultural theorist Homi Bhabha, calls vernacular cosmopolitanism. This is cosmopolitanism from below, where Neo2's long lack of travel, lack of education, lack of class elevation are met at every turn by the riches of imagination, artistic restlessness, and a habitus of expansive aesthetic and ethical reach. Discrepant cosmopolitanism is what resounds the amazement that a non-literate, working-class African musician, one completely aware of the past of Take Five in the racially vexed American 50s and 60s, can so pleasurably regroove it today in a cosmo-inclusive African embrace. And vernacular cosmopolitanism is what resounds the amazement that a non-literate, working-class African musician, one completely unaware of the name Johann Sebastian Bach, can so pleasurably join him to explore the intricacies of hand positioning and the infinite nature of variation with the help of gutters full of ratcheting midnight toads. These positions cross on top and sit below ones critically posed by many other prominent philosophers and social theorists. Are these not stories of what Gerard Delanty calls the cosmopolitan condition of living in translation, of what Gayatri Spivak calls translation as reparation, of what Giorgio Agamben calls co-belonging, of what science historian Donna Haraway calls a companion species manifesto, or what Paul Gilroy calls a planetary humanism, or Walter Mignolo calls diversality, the critical rethinking of universality through diversity, or what Jacques Rancière calls an emancipatory art practice, namely one that is founded on an equality of intelligences. Buffo variations and Ganassi blues present sonic stories where knowing through the audible compels an embrace of the mysteries of others. The mysteries of toads in the gutter, no less the crickets that metrically ground them. The mystery of a stranger named Bach and an even stranger object named harpsichord that sounds his variations. The mystery of a presumed brother named Brubeck, no less an orbiting Cold War radio satellite named Jazz. Not to mention the mystery of having a relentlessly inquiring student whose oxymoronic nickname is Prof. In all, these projects liberate us to listen differently and from an African center to a Western classical and jazz periphery. They compel us to imagine how African traditional musical knowledge and skill might be far more powerfully expansive as cosmopolitan resource than as a reified remnant of ethnicity and nation. They present African experimental music artistry in and as a history of relational listening across time, space, species, and technologies. And from my side, they compel a politics of collaborative activism, where my privileged resources and complementary musical skills can be marshaled to promote an acoustomological flourishing through acts of amplification. I hear that as the politics and the hope of an ethics and aesthetics of cosmopolitan listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Stephen, for that very rich and thought-provoking presentation. We have about 20 minutes for questions, so I invite you, please, to ask them. You're just taking in your breath, are you?
Want to hear more music? First bell, second bell. Windows into Neotu's musical mind that he so generously gave me by recording all those overdubs and allowing me to mix them.
Thank you. So, any questions? Well, I have one. I'll start the ball rolling. This is slightly tangential, so I hope that's okay. And it's to do with the educational environment, the music educational environment that we work in today. You've taught in many places around the world, across many nations and ethnicities, and you've been doing this for some decades now. And without detracting from the uniqueness of the musical world that you've been exploring here and the subjectivities involved, we've encountered this kind of thing, this kind of cosmopolitan impulse in many places around the world. Would you care to say something about the implications of that for music education today in the Academy, considering how it's positioned and how it's located and the kinds of things we generally do?
Well, I think the problem in the Academy now is how to promote in as many ways as possible a healthy and open-minded understanding of the dynamic nature of what's called tradition rather than a reified, authoritative, and foolish version of it. And at the same time, encourage forms of openness and expansiveness and the creation of new kinds of dialogues, translations, and a real embrace of hybridity as modernity through musical interactions with musicians from many places. And unfortunately, speaking about the U.S., what I can say is that world music programs and ethnomusicology programs basically use musicians from many places to create ideas of, to create a kind of guruization of non-Western music and create forms of reified ideas about tradition and hierarchy and authority that don't exist and that are not really part of the incredibly dynamic and open world of real music practice. So the gap between how many musical systems are being taught and what the realities are for musicians is really kind of shocking and surprising to me. And this has been going on for 50 or 60 years now, so I'm not quite sure in whose interests it is to keep promoting this highly reified false version of the concept of tradition at the expense of indigenous musics from all over the place, rather than an understanding of the desire and the history of expansiveness and expansive thinking that musicians have been part and parcel of for a very, very long time. Some of this has to do with economics, some of this has to do with institutions of education. Some of it has to do, I'm sure, with other kinds of things. But I don't think students or musicians or music are very well served by the idea idea of tradition that is being transmitted in music schools.
Thank you. Any responses to that?
I feel like Western culture, which is responsible for so much many different types of violence in the world, has this inherent way of trying to trap other cultures because it sort of resists what I think of as the essence of life, which is change. And I feel like often it doesn't allow us to see that process as it lives in other cultures in constant change. I see that in the notation system that we have in music as well.
Well, what I would say is that I think now is really a wonderful time to explore new forms of partnership, new forms of collaboration, new forms of recording projects, new ways to imagine what it means to be creatively in conversation across large divides of cultural and musical history, space, and time. I was really touched when Neo2 and I toured with Ninoy in Italy, and at the Milan Conservatory, Neo2 sat you know, in a class where he doesn't understand anything in Italian at all, but he sat in a class with the greatest pleasure listening to this lecture on Scarlatti. It was just so amazing to sit with him there and just feel the way he absorbed this whole thing. But, you know, then played at the Circolo Filologico Milanese with his brecchetti wrapped, wanted to wrap his brecchetti in a Ghana national flag. This kind of idea of, you know, wanting to say, you know, I'm a local, I'm from somewhere, I come from a certain something. But when you look at his drum kit, which is a mixture of Ghanaian drums, Indian bells, you know, instruments from all over West Africa, as well as jazz cymbals and things like that. That resounding simultaneity of being rooted and being expansive, you know, was right there. And that's what he listened for, and that's what he wanted to listen with when he was, you know, sat in the classes and with great interest listened to what kinds of stories, you know, were being told to him about how Italian music is taught. And this is what he wanted to know when we went there. He asked our host, he said, well, you know, what do you teach people about music here? And so they said, well, come into this class. And it turned out it was a lecture on Scarlatti. It was marvelous. He sat there for an hour and a half and was totally, you know, wrapped up in this thing. So I think that's, you know, to me, that was an inspiring kind of moment. And it's what inspires the idea that, you know, change is possible. If African musicians can make that leap, I'm sure musicians anywhere and everywhere can make it.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you so much, Stephen, for a wonderful, wonderful lecture. I just had one question about the ethics, the extent to which you think the ethics that you're speaking about are dependent on Nyoto's social position, to the extent that his insulation from the politics of jazz in America and all the things that you spoke about allows him, is the very thing that allows him to partake of this sort of expansive aesthetic sensibility. Mm-hmm. And my point is that there might be a tendency in this idea of sort of vernacular cosmopolitanism to result in the very sort of fetishization of, you know, the guruization of this, of the working poor of Ghana that we're trying to avoid. That, you know, his very position of insulation from the sort of, you know, complicated politics is what enables him to be cosmopolitan, but there's that tension there. So,
yeah, and I take that point. I think that's really good. That, you know, the this is a very complicated story to tell. I mean, if you tell this story in North America, where everybody, you know, assumes they know who, you know, Dave Brubeck is, and they know something about this particular moment, it's very it gets closed down very quickly. What I think is a real opening here is not that Nyoto didn't know that Brubeck and Desmond were white. It's that once he found out that. That simply became part of a fabric of a way of imagining pluralism beyond the tools that he already had to imagine it. The tools he had to imagine pluralism really had to do with ethnicity, nation, and the crossing and movement of musical styles and peoples and languages in West Africa. He's quadrilingual. And so, like many people in West Africa, the understanding of how things fuse and move and what the construction of the urban and modern period is has been, you know, he's born after Ghana's independence in 1957. He was born in 1961. This is really a story which is founded on the movement of language and the interaction of languages and people in, you know, large urban settings like Accra. So what starts out with language and ethnicity and then moves into music and other kinds of the movement and blending of cultural forms and the relationship between traditional idioms that are attached to particular ethnicities or particular ethnic repertoires and then become part of a national fabric or texture around popular dance musics that emerged around the time of Ghana's independence and so forth. There are many kind of models for pluralistic thinking and dynamism in Neo2's world, which you know, come out of language, ethnicity, race, class, and his, you know, his experience. He found the racism, and he found the stories about America. You know, once I showed him documentary films and other kinds of things, he found all of that completely shocking. And you know, what it reinforced was for him was the lack of pictures. You know, that he didn't grow up in a world saturated by images. And that the kind of images of jazz that were shown in Ghana and the idea of jazz that was transmitted in Ghana and the impact of African-American servicemen and the impact of Voice of America, you know, the kind of understanding of what the race and history in West Africa was complicated. So what I found so interesting was that he seized on Voice of America as a site of racial pride. He seized on jazz as a racialized discourse or racialized music. But then, you know, finding out more about the plurality of it was, you know, very natural to him in the sense that he realized that this was like other very complicated interactions and movements of people. And this is something that, you know, he came to explore and think about much more as a result of you know, films and beginning to travel with me in Europe and in the US.
I think you've answered my question before I've asked it, but I'll ask it anyway. Yeah. I absolutely agree with your proposition that jazz is an inherently cosmopolitan form rather than a culturally expressive form, which is quite a scandalous position to mm-hmm. take, but I agree with it entirely. And from there to say that, would it be fair to characterize the process you're describing as really about the creative power of mishearing and then ventriloquism and mimicry and improvisation, and so that the obsession with the real thing and with authenticity mm-hmm. that has motivated a lot of the mm-hmm. passion for jazz is, I think, fundamentally misplaced, and it's you know, its wonderfulness is its that sort of ability to improvise newness out of inauthenticity and mishearing.
Yeah. I think mishearing and misunderstanding are fundamentally implicated in cosmopolitanism. Stuart Hall, in a conversation with Penina Werbner, speaks about this. I think it's the last chapter of Penina's book on the new anthropology of cosmopolitanism. She has this conversation she did with Stuart that's really extraordinary, and he really developed this idea. It's an idea that I associate with him, and that he develops in that conversation and in other places. And I think that is critically important. What's happening right now in this thing called jazz studies is we have what's called Planet Jazz, or the Globalization of Jazz, or Transnational Jazz. There's a new journal, Transnational Jazz Studies. There's new conferences every year on Transnational Jazz Studies. Everybody is getting into the idea that jazz had multiple sources. It meant multiple things in multiple places. You could study it, you know, in Shanghai or Tallinn or Accra in the 1920s, just as easily as anywhere else, and the unitary narrative of jazz starting in New Orleans and moving up the river is, you know, kind of a Disney version. So that's going on. At the same time, there's stronger and stronger and stronger counter-assertions of a very hegemonic, very nationalistic, very imperious U.S. jazz master narrative. The number of times people have responded to the recordings of Accra Train Station with this kind of, who are these Africans to move in on the Coltrane story? You know, I mean, a very nationalist kind of, it's quite shocking, but it's really there. And there are many people, you might find this surprising here, but there are many people here who continue to drone on endlessly, and unfortunately the worst of them are in music schools, drone on endlessly about this America's classical music business. and want to own jazz in a particular kind of way and are very threatened by the idea that jazz has a much bigger story to tell. And that the story of cosmopolitanism and nationalism and U.S. imperialism is one that has to be powerfully, you know, taken apart and you know, gone into now from many angles. I had a wonderful conversation last September in Amsterdam with Darius Brubeck, Dave's oldest son, who's a very fine piano player, as some of you might know. Darius lived and worked and taught in South Africa for 25 years, retired and moved recently to London. And, you know, he told me he loves this stuff. And he said, you know, I can't tell you how many times when I first went to South Africa, but during all the years I was there, people looked at me and said, you're Brubeck, but you're white. This is not an uncommon kind of thing, and the complexities of it and the ironies of it are multiple, and they have yet to be really brought out into the open and explored fully.
Yes.
Where was the common ground you had when talking as musicians, because he was coming from a different sound world than you, so obviously there was a notation or anything between you.
Yeah, so Neo 2 taught me first bells for about 2.5 years, and I learned the kind of generative math of these 35 or so bell timelines, which expand out to a good 110, 120 kind of things that interlock with what the drummer does with his left hand. And then I learned to play an African bass lamellophone called Ashiwa, which has three lamels. And the bottom part of it is played with the thumb, and I would play so you play independent handed. I would play the bell timeline with the left hand, and on the top of it, I could play a combination of other bell and drum parts, inner parts that interlock, as well as explore a number of things coming from Latin jazz and other sorts of sounds. And this is the kind of experimental conversation we've had as side-by-side musicians playing in that group. I also studied Jill, the xylophone, with Neo 2, and we play now duos where I play the bass one and he plays either one or two tenor ones. I've become a bass player.
Well, thank you again, Steve, very much for that wonderful presentation.
And thank you all for these many conversations these 2 weeks. It's really been great to be here. This is 12 years since I've been in Australia, and it's a very vibrant place for me, and with many strong conversations and memories and interactions. And it's really, really been wonderful to be back here. Thank you so much.